So I just wondered if maybe you could see some way of getting more elected people involved in the minor variance part of things, because they're not minor anymore. They're not minor when they divide a piece of property into two and put a driveway across. That's not a minor variance. Minor variance is a small thing. So could you comment on that?
Perhaps I can give you a little bit of insight. The minor variance that you're referring to is through the Committee of Adjustment. And that is an arm's length body that makes decisions based on four tests under the Planning Act. And we have that so that they're not elected officials who make those decisions. And they're people who come from a variety of backgrounds, mostly I would say with some sort of planning expertise. We have somebody on there who was with the Deputy Minister's office at the province, for example. It's very difficult for us, and it's been a sort of unspoken code, shall I say, amongst council that you should not be going to a Committee of Adjustment meeting so as not to influence politically what takes place. I can honestly say the one that I did attend recently, which I have no problems admitting to, was 22 Brookside, where I thought it was horribly handled, and I believe the mayor also attended that one because we were very concerned there was a lack of process in that particular situation. We wanted to bring it to attention of the Committee of Adjustment, and it worked out better as a result. So it's something that maybe we do have to look at in terms of how we work that. But the understanding prior to my coming on and since is that you don't involve, so it's at an arm's length decision, similar to the Ontario Municipal Board, which is another humdinger.
Thank you. I guess one of the key things and why I brought that up is that because I've been able to talk to so many of your neighbors and some of you that are here tonight is that there is a real sense that we're under attack here and that we're not getting the results that we need. I think that we need to take a hard look on how to influence that process, and it is quite true that we have some great technical people on these committees that really look at the hard facts, whereas, you know, I spent 9 years on as chairman of the Traffic Advisory Committee, and that's another issue that you raise here, where, you know, I can tell you lots about the political stop sign situation. So we want to stay away from that, yet there has to be a way for residents to voice their opinion and to be heard. And we need to find a way outside of the box of what we're doing today to ensure that the neighborhoods are protected, that our property values are protected, that there is something that's consistent with the neighborhood now. And there's lots of examples where it's done really, really well. And there's a few examples where it's done really, really poorly. And that's what we need to guard against. And that's what I'm committed to do. Thank you.
Thanks. Another question. Andrew.
Thanks. In both of you sitting here now and previous people, I hear that you are going to represent the people. And on one hand, we have a lot of bureaucrats that are running the town. How do you honestly think that you will be able to deal with the bureaucracy of what is going on and satisfying the needs of the people who put you into the position of where you want to be?
It's a very good question, Andrew. I think a perfect example of that was our previous planning department. We had a planning department previously that by and large was at odds with what the people wanted to see, and it started around the time of Sharkies and sort of lent itself through there. I know that council, and I know especially the mayor, has made a concentrated effort in regards to really going out and seeking people who are in agreement, shall we say, and can support our livable Oakville, our vision for Oakville, instead of fighting us at every development application, are saying, here's the tools we can use, here's what we can do to support your vision and our vision. And for the first time, I can honestly say, we are finally aligned in that. And as I say, the livable Oakville is a perfect example. And time again now, you will see that when planning reports come forward, it's not, we've got to wait and see what the planning department's going to tell us, and do we have to fight with our own money at the Ontario Municipal Board? No way.
Thank you, and I think that's an excellent question, and I'd like to answer it just by talking about an example of something I was able to achieve. And what we did, I was co-chair with Mayor Mulvelle at the time for a forum that we did called Red Carpet, Not Red Tape. In that, we made recommendations that you know, really did streamline a lot of the process. And one of the key things that we really, really pushed was the fact that the customer-first approach. You know, a lot of our bureaucrats are excellent. They're entrepreneurs, they're engaged, they're fabulous people who are very, very talented and love working with the public. But we really, really need to have our frontline people, and we did implement some measures then, and we do need to do so much more now, bringing that sort of customer-first approach where they really look at the person on the other side of the table or the other side of the booth as the customer, and not you're here and you need me, and that we want to really continue. And that's a mindset you have to continue to change. I've been involved in changing that in the past, and it's something that sorely needs to be done still, and I'll be leading the charge on that. So I think that was a great question. Thank you very much.
Thanks. One more question?
Okay.
Sorry.
I was just going to say,
go ahead.
If there's no other questions, could I just give somebody an answer in regards to number 3 Lakeshore Road West and what the holdup was with that particular property? But I'll wait until, I can talk to people afterwards.
Let's see if we have one. Do we have another question? Yes, please.
Who is driving the demolition of the hockey arena? And who is driving the development of the future?
But why don't we let Stephen go first on this one?
Oh, thank you very much. Because I remember even in 1998 on council, we were talking about the Oakville Arena being at the end of its life cycle then. And we made some capital improvements to extend that life, but it wasn't meant to be extended 12 years as far as I know. So one of the things that I have talked is another example of not getting things done in Ward 2. Is, and that we need the attention on these issues, is that, you know, there's been several new twin pad arenas, hockey arenas, all kinds of things that acquired over the last number of years, with good reasons, always good with good reasons, except that our solution right here has not been completed. So my understanding is in 2012 it's going to be demolished, and we need to have a plan. And so we got to make sure as a community that it's a fabulous opportunity to make sure something is on that site that's excellent, that maintains that structure, that maintains something new and exciting, and maybe some added, you know, experience, added things like community meeting spaces or other things like that, that can really be an attraction for us here in the community. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. It's a very good question. When I mentioned that it was slated for decommissioning or demolition, there has not been a final decision at council in regards to that matter. It has been as far back as 2005, there was a planning report giving us, or an engineering report rather, the status of how much longer that arena could last. And Stephen's absolutely right. There was a certain lifespan for the arena. We've been doing yearly audits on the facility to make sure it's perfectly safe. But when I saw in our capital budget that staff were recommending putting $1 million line item for the decommissioning of the arena in 2012, I immediately went to them and said, okay, explain to me why you're already putting in this amount of money if we haven't already made a decision. And it was there, knowing that we're coming towards the end of the life cycle, and I immediately asked, could we not have some money provided, which we now do, to have some sort of a planning exercise to involve the community so that they're the ones who decide whether or not they want to make it a community arena, or they want to make it meeting rooms or whatever, other than just going for twin pad or whatever. And as I said previously, we've never had a master plan done of that. Everything's been done in isolation, and we now own that corner of Rebecca and Kerr, which we didn't before. So it should be treated in its entirety and not just one of.
Thanks, Kathy. One more question.
With the demolition of the arena, did that involve taking down Lyons Pool as well?
No. The Lyons Pool was actually given or donated by the Lyons Club originally. They built that way back when. In fact, Councillor Fred Oliver was instrumental in that at the time. That's why I was saying it's paramount that we have an overall far-reaching plan, because we do have the outdoor pool, we have a basketball court, tennis court, we have two baseball diamonds, I believe we have a bocce court up towards the side, and we now also have a garden plot that some of the Oakville Green people are using for gardens. So we really do have to look at a comprehensive plan as opposed to just saying, plunk, let's go and replace the arena.
Hello,
sorry, Stephen, did you want to respond also?
No, I'll only add that, yeah, comprehensive plan for that whole park is absolutely critical. And, you know, in terms of the pool specifically, I don't have anything really add at this point, but except that, it sounds like something that absolutely must be protected.
Is there any money in the budget for such a plan?
There is no money in the budget as yet, which is why the first order of business when we get back, I would hope, regardless of who is elected, would immediately start that planning process similar to what we are doing with the D&D properties, engaging the public. We've got, I believe it's around $100,000 to get that whole process started, but then we'd have to go to council for budget approval to construct something, but we need to have a plan first before we can go and assign a dollar figure to it and to be able to get some sort of capital project. The other thing I had a concern about was the, and I think I heard somebody mention, the longer downtime we have between when it's decommissioned and when we rebuild is also an issue, because we can't afford to be without recreational and community space in this area. Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you. And I guess that's sort of one of the key points that I've been making throughout this campaign is the lack of teeth on some of these issues. You know, when we talk about the Oakville Arena, there's no plan, and it's been like that for a long period. When we talk about the harbor, it's in there to do something, but there's no plan. When we talk about, you know, other issues like the current village revitalization plan, the plan has been received but not implemented. When we talk about this time and time again, in my opinion, we need to have a new kind of vision for our community and make these things happen. So I have a lot of experience on doing that, and I'd like to have the opportunity to do that for Ward 2. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you both. We're going to wrap it up there and welcome our mayoral candidates to come up and take the stage. Thanks again.